Professor Rai. Thank you, Professor Banga. We now move on to the last lecture of the day. The topic for this lecture is Bihari Overseas Labor Migration, 1857 to 1869, Origins, Intermediaries, and the Role of Trust. This lecture will be delivered by Crispin Bates, Professor, University of Edinburgh, and chaired by Subroto Mitra, Director, Institute of South Asian Studies, National University of Singapore.
Colleagues and friends, ladies and gentlemen, I'll open this session by reminding you of a wonderful evocative word that the literature Alok Roy used. He complimented the organizers of this conference for their audacity. It is audacious to organize something at this scale, pull together contributions with this stretch, and continue it session after session. But if that audacity of the organizers was necessary, by itself it could not have been sufficient to hold you together. I was wondering, what is it that has made over the last 2 days the other agenda a little bit our agenda? It's because the freedom that makes people like us possible. Freedom to imagine, freedom to travel, freedom to expect the state to sustain our kind of inquiry are under threat, which is why Alok Roy said, it does feel a little bit like in a war zone, that the wolf is at the door, that we have to hang together and think, what makes us relevant? What makes us hold our heads high like colleagues in other corners of our playing field who do nuclear physics or molecular biology? It's the defense of this critical freedom. And that is the topic that brings me to Crispin Bates, Professor of Modern History at the University of Edinburgh, former director of the Center for South Asian Studies, a Cambridge man. One of the joys of academic life is to evolve together. I've known him as a doctoral candidate at Cambridge when I was the new blood post in Hull, and I've seen the whole agenda grow of combining critical social inquiry and taking it wherever people live. And today, Crispin is taking us away from India to where Indians go, Indians have been, and helped Europe build bits of hybrid culture far away from home. With these words, I'll give Professor Bates the floor and look forward to a wonderful conversation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for waiting out for this last lecture. I'm very grateful to the organizers of this conference, which has been one of the most spectacularly efficient conferences that I have ever attended, and also to the members of this distinguished audience for being here today. Now, this month, March 2017, G.K. Gokhale proposed a bill to the Imperial Legislative Council proposing the abolition of Indian indentured labour migration. Now, the ending of Indian indentured overseas labour migration was one of the great, has been hailed as one of the great achievements of early achievements of the Indian nationalist movement. But comparatively little has been written about the subject, or very little new has been written about the subject, which breaks from the agenda that was first established by Hugh Tinker back in 1975, when he generalized about the whole system of labor migration as a new system of slavery. Now, the generalizations of Tinker have provided some very useful paradigms for a lot of historians, but I am now involved in a project, a research project funded by the United Kingdom's Arts and Humanities Research Council, the Becoming Coolies Project, which is going to attempt, or is attempting, to rethink some of the paradigms that have been used in discussing Indian overseas labour migration. Now, the project is funded to the tune of £800,000 and is running over the course of 3 years. And it's enabled me personally to visit archives in Yangon, Kuala Lumpur, Assam, Colombo, Mauritius, and Pietermaritzburg in South Africa. And I've just returned from an Indian diaspora conference that was being held in Trinidad. The focus of this project, however, is on the Indian Ocean and the Indian Ocean region, because it is in this region that we see the largest volumes of Indians migrating, not only on indentured labour contracts, but also as so-called free labour migrants as well in the colonial period. And the project is broadly questioning the role of indentured labour migration in the South Asian diaspora. Our hypothesis is that this is only actually a small part of a long history of Asian and migration. We wish to challenge the belief that migrants were entirely unskilled and uneducated, and that they were mostly men. And we also wish to challenge the dichotomous interpretations that emerged since Hugh Tinker's famous book, dichotomous interpretations which have argued that migrants were all either kidnapped or they were all profit-maximizing individuals. And I think the point is that when you're looking at a phenomenon that takes place over more than 100 years, or 120 years, involving multiple generalizations, any such argument becomes unnecessary. Necessarily simplistic. We're seeking in this project to demonstrate that South Asians have been global citizens for far longer than we imagine, which I posit is one reason why India even today has participated so easily and fully in the phenomenon of globalization in the present. And I would like to argue that contemporary second wave South Asian overseas migration is not so different from those that went before. If you talk, well, there have been a number of sociological inquiries amongst Indians working in North America. They often describe themselves as the second wave, as being middle class and educated, distinguishing themselves from the migrants of the 19th century, who were agriculturalists, low caste, and they believe unskilled and uneducated. I want to argue that, in fact, the similarities are far greater than the differences, as I shall go on to explain. Above all, I want to show how to produce all the projects is attempting to bring out examples of networks and of agency within migrant communities before, during, and after indenture, because one fact that is not often realized is that after the end of indenture, of course, migration did continue, but just simply on different contractual bases. And I want to show that these networks created by Indians themselves were more important than demands of employers in the establishment of migration streams. To do this, we're focusing on the effective relationships amongst the migrants, which enable them to evade the dominant structures of colonial regimes, And within this, we're also giving a particular emphasis to the role of both women as well as men in exercising diverse forms of agency, notwithstanding the arduous circumstances of their employment. Along with this goes a questioning of the notions of freedom and unfreedom, defined in classical Lockean terms as a sovereign individual subject, in which will have been debated throughout historical arguments about indentured labour migration. And our thesis, our hypothesis, that upon closer examination, there was more freedom than might be assumed, and the alternatives were often, sometimes, far less free. So what was the indentured labour migration? Well, the indentured contract, or girmit, was a fixed term contract, sometimes for 5 years, sometimes for only 3 years, by which migrants from the Indian subcontinent repaid the cost of their passage by working for a specific employer for a specific period of time. Now, the focus has often been on plantation labour in a lot of the historiography, but it must be remembered that there was an even larger indentured labour workforce in the 19th century, and that was the Indian Army, which remains a million soldiers in the Indian Army served in the First World War in Europe, and the Indian Army today remains an indentured labour force, as do most armies throughout the world. The labourers were known as girmitiyas, or coolies if they were Indians, or singhis if they were Chinese. It's often forgotten that the volume of Chinese migrants, particularly in Southeast Asia, was as great, if not greater, than the volume of Indian migrants. But what made Indian migration particularly controversial was that it was introduced to British colonies specifically in order to supply labour to plantations and mines following the abolition of slavery in 1833. Now, the first indentured migrations migrants actually went to Réunion in 1824. They then began to be shipped from India to Mauritius in 1833, but howls of protest and complaints from various bodies led to the suspension of this migration in 1838. Now, where did these criticisms come from? Well, they came from, first and foremost, from the anti-slavery lobby in London, who feared that indentured Indians were simply being used to do the work of slaves on exactly the same terms and conditions, which was to some extent true. But they also complaints came from the government of India and from provincial governments in India, who disliked the idea of skilled workers being taken out of the country who might be better deployed in mines and plantations within India. This controversy was played out in the Houses of Parliament, and eventually migration was resumed under new legislation and close supervision. And because of the continuing controversy about indentured labour migration, it was in fact the most highly documented movement of labour anywhere in the world right up until the early 20th century. We therefore know more about Indian plantation workers than any other workforce in the world in the 19th century. This migration, we can argue, was nothing new, however. The culture of migration in North India can be traced back to the beginnings of the Delhi Sultanate. It's evident in the poetry and the folklore of the region, with widespread motif is of separation, especially the separation between a travelling husband and a wife. And we know from Dirk Kolff's work on the ethnohistory of the labour market in Hindustan, the important role of migrants from Bihar and the east of UP in the Mughal army and in the East India Company's Bengal army. There were reports undertaken in the 1880s that showed that by this date, Indians in Bihar and East UP knew very well where the prominent destinations were and opportunities lay for overseas labour. There were, in districts which did not typically send labour overseas, there were many rumours about ill treatment. But in the districts that did send labourers overseas, there was a confident knowledge. Destinations were known and even described and compared. Jamaica, for example, was considered a good destination, but little at this time was known either of Fiji or Natal, because they had only just begun to accept migrants. Mauritius, popularly known as Mirich, was less less popular by this time, probably owing to a decline in wages in the 1880s compared with the 1860s. Trinidad, properly known as Trinitat, was particularly popular because migrants, at least in the first few decades of indenture, were guaranteed a plot of land if they chose to stay in Trinidad rather than returning home to India, as indeed a majority chose to do. So these are the principal destinations of these migrants. One of the important things about this migration is indentured labor migration probably totaled about 2 million Indians going overseas in total in the 19th and early 20th century. But this was in fact a small portion of the total number. We will never know the total number because the British did not keep meticulous records in any migration stream other than those on the indentured labor contract. But for example, Sunil Amrit has speculated that as many as 25 million crossed the Bay of Bengal in the 19th century, temporarily or long term, and as many as 7 million settled permanently in Malaysia and Myanmar. So this is the type of work that the earliest migrants did. It was not unlike the work of slaves, and indeed the conditions in the early years were very harsh. Basically, they had to clear the forests in order to enable plantations to be created. Forests which were often suffused with mosquitoes and malaria. Accommodation in the early years was very primitive. But by the 1860s, you're beginning to see Indians who decided to stay on at the end of their indentured contracts establishing permanent settlements with houses and shops. These paintings are from the 1860s. And by the end of the century, of course, substantial buildings begin to be built out of brick with tiled roofs. This is a scene from Kandy in 1895. So the migration in its early years undoubtedly included many who were known by the British as Dangars, including Kol, Santals, Orangs, and Mundas from Chotanagpur. However, the nature of the networks and the movements of labourers changed dramatically after 1857. Migrants from Chotanagpur began to move instead towards Assam, where a new demand for labor in the tea plantations, and those from Bihar and UP began to move overseas. These are the total emigration statistics for the years immediately before and after the Great Uprising of 1857. Now, I was in charge of another big project on the uprising of 1857. Which resulted in a series of volumes, the Mutiny at the Margins volumes published by Sage, 7 of them, which I strongly urge you to go out and buy from any good publisher. Now, these statistics originally came to my notice when I was working on that project. The very large outward migration that came immediately after 1857, and the particular concentration of migrants going through Calcutta. So I decided to look at these Calcutta migrants, and for the period from 1857 to 1869, I got hold of ships lists of migrants that went to Mauritius, South Africa, Guyana, and Trinidad in this period. Now, these ship lists are available in local archives in these places, listing the name of every single migrant, their age, their father's name, their caste, and the village, Pargana, and Zilla, which they came from. And using these statistics, it's only a sample, it's a sample of about 4,600 migrants, I was able to trace exactly where they came from. And as you will see, they were highly localized in their districts of origin, localized particularly in areas which were impacted by the uprising of 1857. And when I say impacted by the uprising of 1857, I refer here to the Bengal army of 100,000, which was decommissioned by the British effectively in this time. All of the native regiments were disbanded, but also the impact on their families. Many families were deprived of their lands. Punitive taxes were imposed upon villages which had supported rebels in 1857. And there were successive famines immediately after 1857, the most conspicuous being in 1861 and 1865. Now, this is all a part of the legacy of 1857. 7, and these were all amongst the districts which were worst affected. Here again is another representation of the zillas where the migrants came from, showing how they were concentrated, particularly in areas of UP and Bihar, East UP and Bihar, which were most affected by the uprising, where most of the recruits for the Bengal army came from. And if we then explore their social status, we come to a rather interesting conclusion. And I have to say, I had no idea that this was going to result from this analysis, but it kind of jumped out at me as soon as I saw it. If you broadly categorize the migrants into groups by caste, Brahmins and Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and artisans, middling caste, Muslims, Dalit and backward castes, and Adivasis, you see quite remarkably that these migrants to Guyana, Mauritius, South Africa and Trinidad between 1857 to 69 represent pretty much a cross-section of North Indian society at their time. The pie chart on the right applies the same analysis I had used to the 1881 census, and you see an extraordinary mirroring. Brahmins and Kshatriyas, 11% of the migrant population, 12% of the population of Bengal and Northwest provinces. Vaishya and artisans, 11% of the migrants, 7% of the population of Bengal and the Northwest provinces. Muslims, 19% of the migrants, 24% amongst the population of Bengal and the Northwest provinces. Now, this is remarkable since the planters had quite specifically insisted that they did not want to recruit high castes. They wanted only labourers. And there's quite a lot of evidence, I mean, we have even from Baba Ramchandra later in the 19th century, of Brahmins actually changing their names and pretending not to be migrants in order to get recruited. So if anything, these statistics underrepresent the number of high caste amongst the ranks of the migrants. Now this leads me to presuppose that many of these migrants may have been from high caste origin or may have been in fact ex-sepoys or from the families of 1857, and therefore refugees from the Great Uprising. Now, their first destination in many cases was Mauritius. Why Mauritius? Well, I would speculate one of the reasons is because when the island was first taken from the French by the British in 1811, Bengal sepoys were employed and indeed were amongst the very first Indian settlers on that island. But this migration post 1857 then proceeded to replicate itself as returnee migrants were used in large numbers to recruit subsequent migrants to these destinations. So these networks amongst the migrants, I would argue, were quite crucial. Migrants maintained close contact with home. We have plenty of evidence of this from letters which have survived from the period. And many re-indentured in the colonies in which they had first arrived, or indeed in other colonies. There's a lot of evidence of this. And old migrants often became returnee recruiters and acted as sardars or foremen, competing with each other for the best wages from plantation owners. Now, one of the themes that I'm touching upon in our research is the importance of women. It's often assumed that all the migrants were men. Well, as early as 1842, the regulations for Mauritius said that 40% of the migrants should be women. For Trinidad, it was initially set more modestly at 12.5%, but it was raised to 40% in 1874. And many women traveled to accompany their husbands, even though they were not actually indentured to work on the tea estates or in the sugar plantations. Some indentured to elope or to avoid marriage. And whilst fraud was certainly evident in some cases, women were not, for the most part, simply passive victims. And some even became recruiters themselves. Through hard labor, inheritance, and entrepreneurship, many Indian women became substantial property owners in their adopted homelands, setting up community organizations and founding religious institutions and family businesses. And they could even become sardars, such as one woman called Sukanya, who was in charge of 16 men on the Clemenceau estate, Mauritius, in the 1870s. Anyone familiar with the history of Indian migration will be familiar with the tale of the Queen of Sheba, a Bihari woman who went out to Trinidad and made a small fortune for herself, not only through inheritance but also through her business practices, who decided on a trip to go on a touristic excursion back to India at her own expense, didn't much like her experience, and so returned then again at her own expense to continue her career. And remarkably, the captain observes, when they arrived at St. Helena, bought up all the fish in the market and threw a feast for all the other coolies on the ship. The lady herself was bedecked with jewellery, according to the captain's description. She's a very good example of the type of individual, not necessarily a typical individual, but the type of some individuals who could flourish from this experience. What was crucial, I think, in enabling this whole migration was the role of intermediaries, described as sirdars or sardars in North India, or kanganis or maestris in South India, or mandor in Malay. They were overseers and recruiters, foremen and labour representatives, described by the British as parasitic middlemen, in contemporary parlance, traffickers. They were and are, I would argue, essential in any economic system. But they were reviled by the plantation owners. But I would argue they are, in fact, evidence of informal social organisation within the labour economy. In Assam, as overseas, the Akati recruiters received a similarly bad press. They were described by Britishers as the scum of the country, ex-convicts, burglars, thieves, dacoits, and notorious budmashes. But other sources describe them as belonging to the very class of people who emigrate as labourers and live and move among them. And one of the things I would argue that is what are commonly described in colonial sources as abuses is in fact evidence of Indians profiting at the expense of the Europeans, which is one of the reasons why they get such a bad reputation. In Mauritius, by the 1860s, sirdars accounted for the vast majority of recruits. Even in 1858, we see the statistics show old emigrants bringing back very large proportions of the migrants to Mauritius. And notwithstanding the complaints and the many objections, the Royal Commission appointed to inquire in the treatment of immigrants in Mauritius concluded the Sirdari system and the use of Sirdars to recruit labourers was absolutely unavoidable. One, they described it patronisingly as something entirely consonant with the habits and customs of the natives of India. But the reality is the planters themselves could not do without these intermediaries who controlled largely the movement of labour. And the movement of indentured labourers to Mauritius, Trinidad, Guyana and South Africa was mirrored by bonded labourers, or labourers who were indebted to Kanganis, who advanced the cost of their passage in migration to Sri Lanka, Myanmar and Malaysia. In these three destinations, well, it's particularly in Myanmar and in Sri Lanka, there was never any indentured labour allowed, but the volumes were equally large, particularly of Tamils migrating, all of whom borrowed money from an individual who would then act as the foreman for their group and guide them as a group to their destination, where they would then repay the cost of their passage. And I could go into great detail, but I mean in Sri Lanka, for example, all of the complaints you actually hear are not from the planters, but actually from Ganganis, who are complaining about workers running away from estates and not repaying their debts. So it's Indian intermediaries are even more powerful in the migration to Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia. This is a photograph of a typical group of Calcutta coolies from the 1900s. And one of the points we need to emphasize, of course, is there was nothing particularly unique about this role of the intermediaries. As Ariane Dahan has written about jute mills and other industries in Calcutta, the process of recruitment has been predominantly personalistic. Recruitment was and still is mainly through personal relations. Now, this is very different from the world that is imagined by the colonial regulations. The colonial regulations imagined individuals signing up signing contracts of service to individual planters and moving as individuals through the system. But the reality is very different. One of the things I like to flag up is where does a Sirdar or a Kangani end and a labour contractor begin? Because you find both in the colonial sources. And the difference is someone is called a labour contractor if they actually do work for the government. If they do work for anyone else, there usually is no written contract. It is merely a verbal engagement involved, and that's when they are therefore called Sirdars or Kanganis. I have here a very good example of one man who was called a contractor, a Pathan called Akbar Shah, who took a group of 200 Pathans to Assam to work on the Assam-Bengal railway, and then took the same group to Yangon to work on the docks then, and his workforce expanded until it was 900 strong, and he was described as the largest labour contractor in the British Empire. He fell foul of the British in 1915 as he was suspected of played a part in inciting the Singapore mutiny of that year. But by that stage, he had become one of the more successful labour intermediaries in South Asia, and there are many others like him on a smaller scale. Now, to enable these movements for people to take place, of course, there has to be an element of trust. The British were very aware of this, which is why they created lots of official documents trying to convince people that this labour migration was being indeed properly regulated by them, and that the planters were answerable to them for their conditions of service. Contracts were issued in multiple languages to try to ensure that migrants knew what they were doing. They had to appear before a magistrate to confirm that someone had explained to them what the contract said about how much they were going to be paid and what sort of work they had to do before they could migrate. And there is evidence that groups of labourers would sign these contracts collectively. So they weren't simply moving as individuals, but as gangs. The depot, however, was perhaps more important than any of this official documentation. The depot and the route to the depot. Villagers would have to walk hundreds of miles in order to get to the depot where they were to embark. And when they arrived at the depot, they would often have to wait many weeks before they could get on a ship to their destination. It was here that information was crucially passed around by old and new migrants about the destinations and what lay before them. And it was often here, if they were not already part of a gang, that labourers would choose to join one. The returnee migrants who were recruiting went with official documentation to reassure people that they were men of good character, as in this example here, the bearer being a man called Dibi Dean. Why? Because there was a lot of obstruction from the local authorities. The police, indeed, particularly, took great pleasure in extracting bribes from returnee recruiters in order to allow them to permit them to carry on their work. We have plenty of evidence also of Sirdars, once they got to their destination, acting as negotiators on behalf of their workers. One of the most interesting things they did in Mauritius, which I know a lot about, is the pooling of wages. Mauritius is notorious for its what was called the double cut, which means if a worker took a day off without prior permission, they were cut for 2 days of their wages. 5 minutes? Yeah. They were cut for 2 days of their wages. Now, what Sirdars used to do was pool all the wages of their workers for the month. The planter would pay, Sirdar would offer to distribute the wages on the behalf of the planter. And then he would pool all the wages for the month, thereby completely rendering ineffective any unreasonable deductions of the planter. This was observed by planters themselves. Rudel, the owner of the Barak plantation, said that he found that the workers had put all their wages into one bag. He couldn't believe that this was for any other than a nefarious purpose, and he banned them from doing it. But we also have plenty of evidence of work of Sardars not only lending at extortionate rates to their workers, but also lending at very generous rates, because it was in their interest to keep the workers together in a band so that they could then re-engage at the end of their contract at an improved rate of pay. And if they did not get improved wages or improved conditions when they re-indentured, they would move off to a large another plantation. This is where you frequently hear complaints about Sardars actually betraying the planters and leading the men astray. For example, after this is one document from 1865. The competition now existing between the planter and the job contractor, who is generally some old Sardar, is now altogether in favour of the latter, who is always able to offer higher wages, exemption from discipline, and continual leave of absence with the same guarantee to the labourer for the payment of his wages. So why are intermediaries so notorious? Well, first of all, they don't fit with the kind of our modern ideas of what a free labour force should be, an individual moving as a sovereign subject within the labour market, relating directly to the employer as to the state. Intermediaries breach national boundaries and defy also territorial ideas of citizenship. They serve both employers and the labourers, so they can be the butt of criticism from both sides. And they inhabit the world of the informal economy. They're beyond the regulation of the state and therefore a constant object of suspicion. And we only get to hear about them when things go wrong. The colonial archives are filled with court cases being taken out by Sardars or against Sardars. But this only tells us that informal methods of arbitration have failed. For the most of the time, Sardars are going about their work without actually ever coming to the attention of the authorities. If we read between the lines of the evidence of the Royal Commission on Labour of 1875, we can all find all sorts of evidence of the Sardars working on behalf of their workers. They are said to enslave their workers by means of loans and advances. But at the same time, if a worker absconds, the Sardar will not report his whereabouts. And this is one of my nicest quotes: "The Sardar does not make the men work as well and properly as they might." And this was a very common complaint against them too. These activities, as I've seen, were interpreted in colonial documents as abuses, but there is plenty of evidence, even from planters themselves. For example, Mr. Antel, who described them, Sardars, as intelligent and useful, and not agreeing that the Indians were always robbed by them, but often representing them very effectively when it came to re-engaging if they decided to stay on in the colony. So I'm going to skip over these slides about caste and overseas migration and come to my conclusions, which are simply that India and South Asia is not a static and conservative society. There is a long history of migration in North India before the era of indenture and which continues after the era of indenture, in fact, which dwarfs in its scale indentured labour migration itself. That despite the assertions of colonial officials, there was substantial evidence that caste and skilled labourers were recruited for indentured migration overseas, and many were probably ex-sepoys. That workers commonly moved from one category of labour to another. For example, the presence of ex-sepoys in the sugar colonies was later often used by newspaper columnists to explain strikes and other militant actions by sugarcane workers. Women played an important and underestimated role in Indian overseas labour migration, and that pyramids of informal effective networks of trust were, and as they still are, crucial in these economic relations, and I would contest often more harmonious and effective than official records and archives might lead us to believe. Intermediaries were thus crucial in providing information and establishing trust in contractual and informal relationships, particularly where the authorities themselves, the British, were not to be trusted. But the neglect of these roles, the role of these intermediaries, I suggest points out the need for us to decolonize our historical and sociological thought and stop thinking about labor migration in the terms idealized for it by the British in the 19th and early 20th century. My larger ambition is to reappraise more generally the role of the origins and identities of Indian, Chinese and other labour migrants in Asia, and to underline the significance or the extent of their contribution to the making of the modern world, which I would argue is just as great, if not greater than Europeans in the same period. Thank you very much. Oh, I can end with some pretty slides. I forgot, mustn't do without the pictures. 1 minute. This is a Sirdar's house from early 20th century Mauritius. This is the inside of his house. This is in the Rosebel camp. This is a Mauritius ship register from 1858, in which you can see all of the details that I used to compile those statistics earlier on. This is a Trinidad immigration certificate from 1861. This is one from Guyana from 1865. Fortunately, these archives allow photography. Records from the Bihar State Archives, of course, have enabled us to explore more about the districts of origin of these migrants. And then we have letters. Dead letters. Very often people from India would write to workers in the plantations, but the workers would have moved on elsewhere. And so the letter would be then returned to the post office, and these letters would often be retained, often hoping the migrant worker would be willing to pay a fee to come and collect them. And so quite a lot of these letters survive. This is a letter from Said Ulisa Begum to her husband in Mauritius. This is a letter in Tamil from Narayanan who is in Mauritius in 1881, writing home. He obviously got the address wrong, and it was never delivered. And this is a letter from Mansahai in Hindi, written to family members in Mauritius as in 1947. That's quite, it's for certain archives only. Fiji and Mauritius, do we find these letters surviving? But there are quite considerable numbers of them. The other interesting thing is also from the 1870s onwards in Mauritius and South Africa, they began to take photographs of the migrants. And here we have a number of them, Gurdin Chama from Gorakhpur, Sajohi Dosad, an old immigrant widow, someone who'd obviously decided to stay on, photographed in 1899. These are two Kshatriyas who arrived in Mauritius in 1882 and 1888. They were actually husband and wife. The husband went first, obviously, and then the wife followed. And this is my favorite picture from 1905. It's captured is a wealthy coolie merchant's miss, who I imagine is how the Queen of Sheba looked like, bedecked in her jewelry, traveling on the ship Sheila in 1877. Okay, thank you again.
Professor Bates, the price you're going to pay for exceeding your allocated time is that we're not going to be able to have the rich discussion that this paper richly deserves. Diasporic studies is a relatively new field, an important field in its own right, but it is also important because it extends our conventional fields, such as the language of these people. How do they tolerate solecism, to connect it to the previous conversation, and how do they go out of the way to teach their children or send their children to schools where they can learn a purer form of the language? Or religion. They make up local religions and cults, and yet given a choice, given a chance, they would get pundits from home and send money, and they would be avid supporters of Hindu nationalism, or for that matter, citizenship. How do they reconcile their two identities as mere labor power and human beings in their own right? Just to answer that question, my institute in Singapore set up an evening of poetry reading by Bangladeshi migrant workers. And Singapore being Singapore, the director was asked, I'm Bengali speaking, to vet these poems out of the fear that they might be turning their alienation into underground political activity. So I read these poems and I reassured them there is nothing subversive about it. Then the poems. One poem sticks in my head. The poet says, he's a worker, that these are not just words. These are drops of liquid combining my blood with machine oil on the paper that you read. Of course, in Bengali, it sounds a lot more sentimental. All of this to say that here's a very rich field. We should have a proper engagement with Professor Bates. We are not going to be able to have that because I have strict instructions to close at, I'm not going to look at my watch very soon. So I'll still take three questions, if you please. There's one hand there, second is Yeah, second, and all right. Okay, we'll start with you. That's the third question. Keep the mic to. Okay. Would you, Shoiba, would you like to ask that question? Okay. Queen Sheba. But that, we'll start with the first question. Will you give the microphone? Please give the microphone to the lady over there. Would you identify yourself, please, and ask your question?
Vanita Damodaran. Crispin, I want to congratulate you on this absolutely fascinating archive you've discovered of the letters. I was wondering whether you're going to be doing any life histories. I mean, the whole idea of networks, personal networks in particular, which is now, you know, a theme in history writing, and I myself have worked on botanical and meteorological networks in India and the Indian Ocean in terms of plants and the transfer of plants and so on. But I was thinking in your case, this whole idea of life histories and tracing these individuals would be absolutely fascinating. And the other point I wanted to ask you is, did they send any priests? Because in Trinidad, Prabhu Mahapatra wrote very evocatively about the fact that they were trying to maintain social structure in Trinidad, and very often to maintain social structure, they were sending priests, Hindu priests in particular. Did you find any evidence of that? Yeah.
Yes. Thank you very much. The second question comes from Professor Jan Breman.
Thank you, Crispin, for a nice presentation, and very interesting to listen to it. What I find a bit understated is the mystery of the Kuli migration. What you have really evocated is a hopeful story that of beings traveling around the world, and not being much different from the current wave of migration. But the current wave of migration makes me think more of those who tried to cross the Mediterranean, for instance, or to walk through the Balkans, than to the expatriates going from India to the United States. Very recently, a new book on slavery and what it meant, what it implied, has been published, The Underground. I don't know if you've heard about it. It, in very evocative ways, it talks about slavery. And that side of Kuli migration has been understated in the study. Indeed, the tears, but also the blood, and also the many who never came back and who died in isolation, in loneliness, also. That side of the story needs to be highlighted in the context of the process of globalization as it went on in the colonial period.
Thank you. Is there a third question? There isn't. So, Christine, you have the floor. You take 2 minutes to answer the two questions.
Okay, so I'll do the last question first. If I didn't understand it, I pick up on everything you said, Jan, but as far as the migration of refugees in Europe is concerned, someone came across an analogy recently which I rather liked. Rather than talking about these migrants as refugees and the people who are enabling their movement as traffickers, might we also not think of them as being comparable to the Underground Railway in the United States, which helped slaves to escape from persecution in the southern United States? In which case, these traffickers are not necessarily all bad, but some of them may be actually doing exactly what people need them to do, which is to help them to transgress the boundaries and the rules and the regulations imposed by the state, which wants to prevent them from moving. And it's often been observed that, you know, there is no reason why North African and Middle Eastern refugees should not just buy a ticket on a plane or a boat. They're prevented from traveling safely by the regulations of the European Union. And the traffickers are for ill or for better, are simply enabling people to get to where they want to go. They're satisfying a need which no one else would fulfill. And this is undoubtedly illegal, but in the 19th century, the same sort of thing was happening, but it was legal. And you find, therefore, just as you have with traffickers, good and bad traffickers and good and bad intermediaries, and you find many of the traffickers actually coming from the ranks of the migrants or refugees themselves. They're not a different class of people altogether. Dying alone, well, that's one aspect that I have observed. I was reading just last month the records for the period 1900 to 1910 in the Mauritian archives. And as indentured labor migration tails off and the demand for sugarcane plantation sugar begins to decline, you do see rising unemployment in the colonies. And a lot of indentured migrants take to other occupations. They buy land if they've saved. They become hawkers and peddlers. They become hairdressers, they become barbers, they become fruit and vegetable sellers, but indeed some do just become vagrants and die rather a pitiful death. This was the fate of many, of course, of the working classes in the 19th and early 20th century. And it should not be forgotten, at the same time as indentured labour migration began, children were still being sent down to work in mines in Britain in the early 19th century. And there is no end to this story of exploitation. But what we're interested to, but rather than repeating that truism, we're interested to find the creative ways in which people manipulated the system and escaped, because I think that is the story that has been not given sufficient emphasis. It is not to deny the oppressive and exploitative nature of the system in which they survived. To go to Vanita's questions, life histories, yes, that is one part of our project. Indeed, if you go to our website, we have a Facebook page called Global South Asians, which I would urge you to follow. And on that Facebook page, you'll find a link to our project website. On that project website, we are actually putting up successive life stories of migrants, which tells more about the richness of their experience than the simple statistics in which they're normally represented. As far as social structures are concerned, I mean, the interesting thing is the further people go, and the less they retain of caste and other social structures from the Indian subcontinent. In Trinidad, you know, people proudly proclaim that caste is completely dead. In Mauritius, caste does survive, but in a very different form from present-day India or even India at that time. The elite caste, the so-called Babujis, are comprised mostly of Bhojpuris, speakers of who were amongst the very earliest migrants and who therefore managed to establish themselves most successfully in the economy. If you go to Malaysia, migration to the tea plantations and the rubber plantations of Malaysia continued as recently as the 1950s, and those migrants still maintain a connection, a very strong connection with their villages of origin, and indeed only tend to intermarry amongst themselves.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to bring it to a close with two thoughts for you to take away. First, diasporic studies is a very promising new area, particularly for younger colleagues. You have an opportunity here for good funding and good research topics. You'll find, once you start working on the diaspora, how fixed categories become malleable, how you find the result of new technologies changing the way the migrants used to look at themselves. Are they just overseas Indians, or have they become Mauritians? I mean, earlier you had to choose between one or the other. Now the territorial state is stretching itself out, OCI, persons of Indian origin card, and there is cash in it for the states concerned. So this is a very important and interesting field of study. You have had a very nice, precise description of the field. You can connect with it in terms of the conceptual apparatus of your respective field. The second thought, if you have not read it, please pick up a copy of The Sea of Poppies. It could not have been very far from here. Then you'll float down the Ganges and you'll see how North Bihar travels all the way, invents a new language, which is a hybridization of French and Maithili and Bhojpuri, and how those people struggle to discover themselves on foreign soil as not just migrant labor, but as human beings. That Sea of Poppies, Amitabh Ghosh. Thank you, Crispin. Thank you all. Have a pleasant evening.
Thank you, Professor Bates. Thank you, Professor Mitra. There are slight changes in the program for tomorrow. You've been emailed the changes a couple of minutes back. Please check your emails. The first lecture tomorrow starts at 9:30 a.m. in this hall. Can I please request you to move for dinner to the Lumbini Hall now? Thank you. The first lecture tomorrow morning will be given by Professor Imre Banga on the earliest documented locations of Hindi literature.